Don Larson lent his touch to the festivities on Yogi Berra Day on July 18, 1999, recreating the last out of his perfect game by throwing the ceremonial first pitch to Yogi. The duo witnessed more perfection that day when David Cohn entered baseball immortality with his perfect game. And David, as I offer you condolences on the loss of a friend in Don Larson, it seems fitting as we welcome everyone back on Hot Stove to ask you about that day. It's momentous enough to pitch a perfect game, but how surreal was it for you to know that Yogi and Don Larson were both in the building?
Well, it is remarkable, Jack. I think that the further removed I get from that day, the more appreciative I am of everything that surrounded that day and what it meant. And that signature moment to be connected with Yogi and Don is something that I'll forever be thankful for. And I know David Wells feels the same way. I think David Wells obviously threw his perfect game in 1998, and he kind of brought Don Larson back into the spotlight because they both went to Point Loma High School, but to have Don throw out the first pitch that day was something I'll never forget.
That forever connection between yourself and Wells and Larson forged an interesting friendship. Can you describe for us what your friendship was like with Larson?
You know, it really did grow from that day forward. I know that there was an obvious connection between Larson and Wells and San Diego and the Point Loma High School connection, but we really did grow much closer over the years. We did a lot of appearances together. We did a lot of autograph sessions together. I think we all took pride in the fact that we were the three amigos, the three that had thrown perfect games in the old Yankee Stadium, and that was something that would could never be replicated because, there may be a Yankee that throws a perfect game in the future, but I think we all three felt connected that we did it in the old stadium, and we all had great deference to Don, and we called him the Godfather because he was the World Series. He was the one who did it in the World Series. He's still the only one to ever do it in a World Series game, so we kind of referred to him as our Godfather.
David, when we talk about Yankee legends, it's Ruth and Gehrig and Mantle and DiMaggio and Yogi. Larson, though, was a Yankee legend in his own way because of that one memorable day. How did you see him live up to that and observe his place in history?
It really is kind of the underdog story that, that Don Larson wasn't your prototypical Yankee legend that we see on Yankeeography so often. He was a unique character, and he was a flawed guy, like Wells and myself. I think we all kind of reveled in that we all were kind of imperfect in our own ways. But he was a great story in that he really did rise to the moment that you can do that in baseball. You can have a signature moment in one game and make it stand, a singular game achievement that can stand the test of time. And I think he really appreciated that. And he probably more than anybody thought about that game every day for the rest of his life, up until the end of his life. I think he admitted it and he talked about it, and how you could just imagine, when we were sitting around having a couple of pops together, and he would tell some stories from that day that it was almost like he was reliving the moment. And that's how much that moment meant to him. And it really does speak to, that anything can happen on any given day in a baseball game. And Don Larson is probably the best example of that.
You talk about reliving the moment, and there were so many neat moments that went with his perfect game, right up until the fact that he didn't know he was pitching that day until he saw a baseball in his cleat. When you had conversations with him, were there other elements of that day that he told you about that just made you shake your head?
Yeah, he really talked about that he didn't understand what was going on that day, and I know he said this on the record a few times, but, he didn't really know what a perfect game was. Nobody really knew. There weren't that many perfect games. There certainly, weren't that many up until that point. I think it was over 30 years in the major leagues since the last perfect game, and so he didn't really even understand what was going on. I think we both related that the nervousness that you feel in the later innings and the obvious superstitions that baseball players have, and it's sometimes you're the loneliest guy in the dugout and you need somebody to talk to you. And And having talked to Don Larson kind of inspired me to actually say something to David Wells during his perfect game in 1998. And for me, during my perfect game, it was Joey Davis. And it wasn't anything profound. It was just something to break the ice, something funny that can break the ice. And, you know, with Joey Davis, it was him telling me he was a catcher in the minor leagues and that, he could warm me up in between innings. And that's what he did. He actually warmed me up in between innings in one particular inning. And, you know, I was a little leery to throw the ball very hard to him. But he kind of joked with me and said, you know what, I was a catcher. And, you know, that's how nervous you are as a pitcher in that situation. And nobody will talk to you and all the superstitions. And I think we all three related to that probably better than anybody.
So when you and Wells and Larson would get together, I'm sure that you're telling your old baseball stories. I'm sure there was a little bit of trash talking as well. Did Larson ever critique your perfect game and or your pitching style? Did he ever give you any advice about your own pitching?
Not really. I think, you know, the thing we talked about more than anything were mechanics, because I was enamored with Don Larson and the mechanical changes he made right before that game. He was really the first pitcher to use the no-wind-up delivery. He almost had a quick-pitch delivery that caught a lot of players off guard, a lot of batters off guard. And I know in that particular game, his rhythm was so fast, he would just get the ball and throw it with no wind-up, almost just a stride towards home plate and a release of the baseball. And, you know, I think we talked more about that, about mechanics and styles and different pitchers that he admired, and, you know, from Whitey Ford to different great pitchers that he pitched against, even Bob Gibson through that era. So I think it was more about mechanics as opposed to any critique of style or pitches that we threw.
Pretty amazing that day. As he was pitching a perfect game, Whitey Ford was warming up in the bullpen. That was one element of the day that I remember. But, David, I want to throw you a little bit of a curveball here. If you were picking an all-time Yankee team of the players you'd like to spend some time with, not necessarily the greatest Yankee players in history, but the guys you'd like to hang out with, how quickly are you adding Don Larson to your team?
Yeah, Don would be in that mix. Yeah, he'd be one of the first guys drafted, because he liked to have a good time, and he liked to talk. He's a social guy. He really liked being around people, and I think that's what made his perfect game so remarkable, because he didn't like being alone. That's one of the reasons why he didn't stay in his hotel room at night. He needed to get out and see people and be out and about. And, you know, he was very similar to David Wells in that regard. David Wells was one of those guys that you just couldn't keep in his hotel room. It would do him no good. He needed to be out and about. He needed to be socializing. So, you know, Don Larson would be right on top of that list. You know, along with Moose Gowron and Hank Bauer, they'd be right up there as well.
Well, David, listen, once again, our condolences and thanks for sharing some of your insight about